हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, लेट्स स्टार्ट विद द टॉपिक थायरिस्टर टर्न ऑन मेथड्स। सो टू टर्न ऑन द थायरिस्टर मीन्स वी नीड टू स्विच थायरिस्टर फ्रॉम ऑफ स्टेट टू ऑन स्टेट। सो टू टर्न ऑन द थायरिस्टर वी नीड टू अप्लाई सम वोल्टेज सप्लाई टू द SCR सर्किट। सो व्हेन वी अप्लाई वोल्टेज सप्लाई टू द SCR सर्किट, what happens in this case, anode is made positive with respect to cathode. Anode is made positive with respect to cathode means this is the SCR part, this is anode, this is cathode, this is gate. Okay, so to turn on the SCR we need to apply some external voltage supply to the SCR circuit. This is the only SCR device. This device is connected to some elementary circuit. Okay, so anode is made positive with respect to cathode. When anode is made positive with respect to cathode, thyristor can be turned on and it switches from off state to on state. So to turn on the thyristor, we need to follow some techniques. So what are those techniques? That is, here first one is the forward voltage triggering technique. In forward voltage triggering technique, what happened? In forward voltage triggering, when anode to cathode forward voltage, this is the anode to cathode forward voltage. Okay, so when anode to cathode forward voltage is increased with gate open, this part is open. Okay, so when anode to cathode forward voltage is increased with gate circuit open, the reverse bias junction J2 will break. So I already told you in the previous section that thyristor consists of four layers. This is anode, cathode, this is gate, this is J1, this is J2, this is J3. When anode is positive and cathode is negative, J1 is forward bias, J2 is reverse bias, J3 is forward bias. Okay, so at this stage, when anode to cathode forward voltage, this voltage VAK. So anode to cathode forward voltage when increased with gate circuit open means we should not apply any kind of gate supply. Okay, so this reverse bias junction J2 will break. So this breakdown of junction J2 is known as Abelin breakdown, and the voltage at which Abelin breakdown occurs is called forward breakover voltage VBO. I already told you forward breakover voltage VBO. At this voltage level, the J2 junction will break down. So at this voltage, thyristor changes from off state to on state. Thyristor changes from off state to on state. Off state means high voltage with low leakage current. You just remember the VI characteristics. This is IA, this is VA, this is minus VA, this is minus IA. So when this VBO label is reached, thyristor changes from off state to on state. So this part is the off state. Here voltage is high, voltage is gradually increasing, and with low leakage current, this part is the low amount of leakage current. And from this off state to on state, thyristor switches. On state characterized by low voltage across thyristor. So this is the low voltage drop across the thyristor because voltage suddenly reduces and with large forward current. This is the large forward current in on state. This is on state and this is off state. Okay. And what happens when J2 junction break down? J1 and J3 are already in forward biased mode, and breakdown of junction J2, what makes happen? It allows free movement of carriers across three junctions, and as a result, large forward, this is the forward anode current, this is large forward anode current flows. Okay. So when J1, J2, J3 all are J1, J3 are already in forward bias and J2 breakdown, so that all the three junctions allows free movement of carriers across three junctions. Okay. So as a result, large forward anode current flows. This is large forward anode current flows. This forward current is limited by load impedance. I already told you, if this is our the elementaries, I already show you in the elementary circuit part in the previous section. Here is one load circuit. Load is connected across the elementary circuit. So this load is responsible to limit the forward current. Whatever current will flow through the SCR after switching to on state, so these forward current is limited by load impedance. Okay, so transition from off state to on state is obtained by exceeding VBO. Understood clearly? But this method of triggering is never employed. Why? Because at this part voltage is also high, and then suddenly when VBO reached, breakdown occurs, current rises rapidly. So voltage level is higher and current is also high. So when voltage is higher level, current is also at higher level, so it may destroy the device during conduction. So this method of triggering is never employed. Clear? So another some points are here I need to explain. Those are the magnitude of forward and reverse breakover voltage are nearly same. This is the VBR. This is VBO, forward breakover voltage, and this is VBR, reverse breakdown voltage. So these two voltage magnitudes are nearly same and both are temperature dependent. So what happens in so practically VBR, this voltage is slightly more than VBO. Okay, this voltage is slightly more than this voltage, so that forward breakover voltage is taken as the final voltage rating of the device during the design of SCR. So while we are designing the SCR device, what we consider while choosing these voltage levels, that VBO, forward breakover voltage, is the final voltage rating of the device during the design of SCR applications. So when after the avalanche breakdown occurs, J2 junction loses its what? Blocking capability, because this junction only block In this mode, in the forward brick, forward voltage triggering mode, initially this is forward bias, this is forward bias, this is reverse bias. This means only J2 has the blocking capability. So after avalanche breakdown reached, J2 loses its reverse blocking capability. So that if anode voltage is reduced below VBO, so if now we reduce the this voltage, anode to cathode voltage. Now if we reduce this voltage below VBO, SCR will continue conduction of current, because once this is this J2 breakdown, there is a there is no depletion layer. So now the current can conduct smoothly or continuously. So if we reduce this VBO, if we reduce this anode to cathode voltage below or less VBO, less than VBO, then SCR will still in conduction mode, and it still conduct the current or flows the current. Okay, so the SCR can now be turned off by only reducing this anode current below a certain level. I already told you in the previous classes that SCR can turn off by only reducing the anode current below a certain value, which is called as holding current. Okay, holding current. Now you understood clearly how under forward voltage triggering SCR can turn on and switches from off state to on state by increasing this anode current and reached up to the level VBO. So when VBO level reach, current rises rapidly. So here voltage level is also higher, current level is also higher. So this method of triggering, forward voltage triggering, is never employed as it may destroy the device. So in gate triggering, turning on off thyristor by gate triggering is simple, reliable and efficient. Okay, and this method of triggering is usually most usual method. This method of triggering is maximum used method. Okay, so what happens under this technique, let's continue. Okay, so this is the thyristor. This is anode, cathode, this is gate. Already we supply some external source to the SCR device to the circuit. Okay, this is the gate. So what happens in this technique? So a thyristor, in the previous section, what happens? A thyristor with forward breakover voltage higher than the normal working voltage is chosen. In the previous section, this voltage VAK, let the supply voltage is 400 volt, and this now we increase this voltage up to let its value 800 volt. So when this forward breakover voltage, this is the VBO level. When this forward breakover voltage higher than the normal working voltage, then only SCR fires or triggers. This means thyristor will remain in forward blocking state with normal working voltage across anode and cathode with gate open. So in the previous triggering method, in forward voltage triggering method, what happens if our normal working voltage level is at 400 volt and gate is open, and we will not increase this anode to cathode voltage to the label VBO. So what happens at this stage? Thyristor remain in forward blocking state. Okay, so when we increase this voltage to VBO level, then only thyristor changes from forward blocking state to forward conduction state. But this method is not employed, as thyristor may destroy. So to turn on the thyristor at this triggering method, what we need, what is required, that a positive gate voltage between gate and cathode is applied. A positive gate voltage is applied between gate and cathode. Okay, so with gate current, so once this switch is closed and positive gate voltage applied between gate and cathode, then gate current established. Okay, so with this is the gate current IG. So when gate current established, charges are injected into the inner P layer. So let me draw the layer diagram so you can understand in better way. Anode, cathode, gate. This is positive, this is negative, this is positive. Okay, so this is IG. So when gate voltage is applied, then gate current is established. So once gate current is established, charges are injected into the inner P layer. This is the inner P layer. In this direction, current will flow. That means in this direction, electron will flow. So charges are injected into the inner P layer, and voltage at which forward breakover occurs is reduced. So again, I will draw this diagram. This is IA, this is VA. Okay, this is VBO level. So when charges are injected into the inner P layer, voltage at which forward breakover occurs is reduced. So when gate current is, this is let IG1, when gate current is established, now from this level to directly transient from this state to this state, and current rises. So here the voltage level is let V1. So in the previous case, VBO level is here. Now VBO level is here. Okay. That means forward breakover voltage is reduced. The forward voltage at which the device switches to on state depends on the magnitude of gate current. So gradually, if I increase the gate current magnitude, let it be IG2, again VBO level is reduced to V2. That means IG2 greater than IG1, greater than the first stage where IG is equal to 0. So at this phase, forward breakover voltage is VBO. At this stage, forward breakover voltage is V1. At this stage, forward breakover voltage is V2. So VBO greater than V1, V1 greater than V2. Then that means gradually V2 reduces. So this forward breakover voltage magnitude, forward breakover voltage depends on the IG magnitude or gate current magnitude. Okay, so higher the gate current, lower is the forward breakover voltage. Clearly understood? This part you can better understand by this diagram, by this graph. I'll show you the graph. See the graph. is gate current, this is forward breakover voltage right here, VBO. And the graph phase, like this, okay. Just let me draw first. This label is VBO, this is 0, X, Y, Z, A, IG1, IG2, IG3, okay. So what happened at this graph, how we understand how the gate current and voltage VBO relate to each other, how the VBO vary with gate current. Let's see. When positive gate current is applied here, positive gate current is applied, gate P layer is flooded with electrons. Gate P layer, let's see this part, PN, this is anode, cathode, gate, positive gate, anode positive, negative. So when this is IG, when positive gate current is applied, gate P layer is flooded with electrons. So I told you already, this is P plus, N minus, P minus, N plus. So if current will flow in this direction, electron will flow in this direction, okay. So P layer is flooded with electrons from cathode. This is because cathode N layer is heavily doped as compared to gate P layer, okay. This is N layer, majority carrier is electron, and again it is heavily doped layer. So and connected to cathode negative, that's why electrons from this layer will flow towards the inner P layer or gate P layer. That's why P layer is flooded with electrons. As the thyristor is forward biased, it is forward biased, that means J1 forward bias, J2 reverse bias, and J3 forward bias. These states are the initial condition. So as the thyristor is forward biased, some of these electrons reach junction J2. Now the electrons flooded in the P layer reach junction J2, that means reach to the depletion layer. So what happens? At last, width of depletion layer around junction J2 is reduces. So by reducing the depletion layer, by the reduction process of the depletion layer, width of depletion layer at junction J2, what happens? At last breakdown occurs at an applied voltage lower than forward breakover voltage. So by gradually reaching the electrons at this layer, at this inner P layer, the depletion layer, the width of depletion layer around junction J2 reduces. So by this process, gradually what happens? Breakdown occurs. So when the breakdown occurs, at the voltage level at which breakdown occurs is the less voltage, which is the voltage at which breakdown occurs, is less than the applied less than the forward breakover voltage. So the voltage at which J2 junction breaks down at applied voltage is whatever the A2K voltage. So at this level, the voltage at which J2 junction breaks down is lower than the breakdown forward breakover voltage VBO. So VBO level below the VBO level, J2 junction breakdown. Okay, so this is the initial VBO level. When gate applies, IG1 applies, IG1 apply, after applying IG1, VBO level reduces to V1. After then, again, if I increase the IG level IG2, the VBO level decreases to V2. Okay, so if the magnitude of gate current is increased, see, if the magnitude of gate current increases, more electrons will reach junction J2. More electrons will reach junction J2. As a consequence, what happens? Thyristor will turn on at much lower applied voltage. So here IG increases, VBO level decreases.